Hi, everybody. I'm Patricia Duff, and welcome to The Common Good. And we've got a very exciting edition of our Rising Leaders series. Before we begin tonight's conversation, I'd like to welcome a few VIPs and honorables in the audience, particularly former New York State Senator Franz Leichter, New York State's former First Lady, who is also on our honorary advisory board, Sildewall Spitzer, Nancy Collins from the press, and others, too many, too numerous, and all of you are so important to our political life. At The Common Good, what we try to do is give our members a chance to meet leaders in government, media, business, and academia for meaningful conversations about policies and politics that shape our nation. We're really dedicated to sharing ideas because we know that change can happen one conversation at a time. But with your support, we'll continue to fight misinformation and division by presenting high-quality discussions and briefings like today's to create a community that values thoughtful, reasoned debate and to find common ground. If you support these ideals and haven't done so already, please consider joining The Common Good. We would be thrilled to welcome you. Today, we're honored to have a rising star with us, Representative Chrissy Houlahan. She just went down to the floor to vote, and she's expected back momentarily, and we're really thrilled to have her. Houlahan is a bit of a Wonder Woman who's excelled and led in so many areas. She was an Air Force veteran, as well as the first woman elected to represent Pennsylvania's 6th Congressional District. Serving in the Air Force, Chrissy helped launch several thriving companies, worked as a chemistry teacher for Teach of America, and led and scaled a nonprofit organization focused on promoting children's literacy.
Hi, everyone.
Here she is. Okay, great.
Hold on. Sorry.
Well, we're so glad you're here, Chris. I was just giving you a little intro. You look like one of our frontline nurses there for a second, or doctors. I was just saying what a Wonder Woman you are, and how fantastic you've been as a voice in Congress, working your vision of a country united by common values. So, Chrissy, thank you so much for joining us today.
Of course, of course. I apologize for being a couple minutes late. I'm also running between votes, and I was hoping that the next vote would be called at 4, but they haven't yet called it. So I might have to literally run to make some votes and then come back. But I look forward to this conversation, and I apologize for being so frantic.
Well, we're going to operate on the understanding that we don't know how long we're going to have you, and Kay Koplovitz is here to help us out. We are very excited to have our good friend Kay Koplovitz, who's on our honorary advisory board. She's a groundbreaking leader in the media industry, the founder of the USA Network, and the first woman in history to head a television network. I'm always in awe of you, Kay. She's also the founder of Springboard Enterprises, which really helps bring women founders to full parity in raising capital. Kay, thank you so much for joining us. And with that, I pass the conversation over to you.
Thanks so much, Patricia. Really glad to be here with the Congresswoman Houlahan. My first question for you, with all your varied background, is what motivated you to run for Congress?
Sure. And it seems like a fair enough question and a complicated answer. I do have a really diverse background that really never anticipated running for any sort of elected office. I served in the military, of course, right after school with a background in engineering. And then from there, grew a company that focused on basketball apparel and footwear. And from there, moved into corporate social responsibility, or ESG focused organizations. And from there to the chemistry classroom and to growing a nonprofit focused on early childhood literacy. And so for me, my path, even though it seems erratic and eclectic, had a through line, and the through line was one of service, whether it was in service of country through the military, or in service of good business, or in service of our kids and communities and education. I thought I was, as a regular citizen, doing my job, you know, and participating in our country and our economy in the best way that I knew how, including raising my own kids as well. But for the very first time in 2000, I guess it was 16, I felt as though I didn't recognize the government that I had been raised to serve in, and I didn't recognize some of the choices that we as an electorate were making about the government. I had been raised by one Democrat and one Republican, mom and dad, a really purple family and lived in a really purple community. But I really was frankly worried about the trajectory of our democracy and the Republic in the election of 2016, and kind of did an inventory of my background and abilities, and decided that the best use of myself at this point of time was to try to be helpful and to try to serve in elected office. And I frankly decided that I was not young enough to be able to climb the ladder, so to speak, and felt I was qualified to be able to serve in a place like Congress. And then I represented my community well. So decided to run for Congress with every anticipation, frankly, that I would not be successful, because this is a purple place that I serve in. And this is a equally divided Republican, Democratic, and a lot of independent folks. But I thought that in running, I would at least provide an example and at least give the opportunity for people to see a different opportunity. And I'm grateful to be here right now. I am now in my third year. I still serve a very purple place, and I'm really grateful for the chance to try and take all those backgrounds and skills here to Congress, which unfortunately are very uncommon. All of those different backgrounds are not necessarily prevalent in this Congress.
So moving on to serving your constituents in the 6th district and talking about the infrastructure bill, can you break it down to what does it mean to people in your district and what people across the country in their hometowns can expect out of the infrastructure bill should it get passed?
I hope it gets passed too. I'm ready. I got my voting card right here.
You can leave and vote anytime now.
I actually might have to run for a few seconds and go vote on something else. We are now in the midst of a series of 6 votes, and I've done just one of those. But I think what the infrastructure bill, separate from the Build Back Better bill, does is what would normally be termed the hard infrastructure aspects of the economy, and supporting and shoring up those areas of bridges and railways and tunnels, safe water, making sure that we all have access to broadband equitably. Those are some of the fundamental things that I think our economy has been crying out for a long time for us to invest in, not just, you know, this last administration or this administration, but rather for a very long time. I'm privileged enough to have been able to travel around the world previous to this job and to see the different infrastructure plays that our competitors and allies are doing around the world. Mm-hmm. And I wish that more Americans had the opportunity to see what we're up against. And how refined that infrastructure is. And so I'm really looking forward to the opportunity to vote for the infrastructure bill. I was ready months ago to vote for that sucker. And I'm hoping that it's coming as early as possibly today, tomorrow, or this weekend.
Well, thank you for that. Really, you have been a very strong proponent for the paid family leave. It has been in the proposed bill in Build Back Better. It has been out. As of this morning, it seems like it's back in. I just love the people here to hear your perspective on the need to have it, what it means to your constituents, and what it means across America.
Sure. It is one of those things that is something that I've worked on since coming to Congress. I was helpful in the NDAA, which is the defense authorization process, to get family leave for federal employees, 2.1 million federal employees passed a couple years ago. I was helpful in shoring that up and making sure we didn't have any gaps in that last year. And in this year's NDAA, we're finally hopefully going to be able to harmonize that across all the armed services, so that every service, regardless of which one you serve in, has a consistent amount of leave of 12 weeks and consistent for men and women for both sides of the family. And so this is something that I'm passionate about because it's personal to me. I served in 1992. I was pregnant with my first child and really had a problem with trying to figure out how to navigate the fact that I had at that point 6 weeks of leave for childbirth, but also a 6-month base waiting list. So I had this sort of gap in coverage, so to speak. And the assumption was that I was the woman in the relationship, to be honest, and that my husband likely would be the one who was serving and wearing the uniform. And he, in fact, was not. He's a civilian. And so this was something that was really hard for me to figure out how to navigate as a young mom when I separated from the military, in part because of this issue, but not completely. I joined the board of a child care resource center to try and figure out how to help people who struggled with the same issues that I had with raising my family. And for me, the important aspects of the family leave or medical leave is that this is obviously helpful for families. And it helps them to be able to have continuity and to be able to, you know, grow their careers successfully. But it's also really important for the economy writ large, because this is an opportunity for us to grow up our workforce, literally. If you have to end up leaving the workforce as a woman or a man for a certain amount of time and pick it back up whenever you're able to, you're behind and you're not producing for the economy in the way that you could if you were able to have a certain determined amount of leave. And also, frankly, you're benefiting that child or that person that you're caring for in the case of elder care as well. And so this is, you know, an important thing that isn't just for individuals. It's not just for moms. It's not just for families. It's for this society at large. So it's in the bill right now, but I don't know that it will stay. To be honest, it's not okay, but it's okay. I think part of one of the things that we struggle with as a nation and as a government right now is we need to be able to compromise. And we need to be able to get, you know, the perfect cannot be the enemy of the good. And if my perfection is, you know, family leave, and I stand on the sidelines and don't allow real progress to happen, historic progress to happen, then shame on me. So I'm hoping that a lot of my colleagues don't do that for whatever their individual project is.
Right. I mean, I think we could talk at length about the lack of a common good, as you're saying, in our political process today. And do you have any thoughts about how do we change it? Can we move back to more, a consistent common good? Because right now it doesn't appear to be there.
So I think
at all. I'm sorry, I want to jump in here really quick and just say, Chrissy, you've got 7 minutes and 9 seconds left, and there are 100 people who've not yet voted.
All right, I'm getting my cot out so that I'm ready, and then I'll sprint across the wall. So what I would say to that is, I think that civility and decency, I would hesitate to say is dead, but it's definitely on life support. And I think that we need to recognize that this is how we get things done, is to work together, to work collaboratively, to listen to one another, and to be exposed to one another. I'm fortunate enough to have been not only a military member myself, but also a child of military folks too. And moving around really has that benefit of being able to see that we have a lot in common, a lot more in common than we do differently. And being able to collide with each other in different places is also something that we don't have anymore. So one way that I think we can be helpful in this area is with national service. I'm not at the place where I would say that it's a mandatory national service, but I do think it would be very helpful to create more pathways for people to be able to serve, whether in the military or otherwise. I did Teach for America as well. These are places where we can kind of collide with each other in a way that we don't right now, and where we can also be force multipliers and be able to have more effect, you know, that one person have more effect. For instance, when I was teaching chemistry in North Philadelphia, I believe that I had an effect on everyone in my classroom, I hope, but also the parents around. I know they had an effect on me. They certainly gave me a perspective that I never would have had otherwise on the inequities of our education system. So those kinds of elevations of national service is one way. I think also electing people who want to serve their communities by bringing people together rather than bringing them apart. We try to have very deliberate town halls that are very deliberately structured, much like a classroom, in the sense that we have norms, we have ways that we're trying to behave with one another, and expectations of how we are going to communicate, and a curriculum, you know, of what we're going to be talking about. So I do think we need to hit the reset button. And I think a lot of times it means doing it in person.
Mm-hmm. Thank you for that. I wanted to move on to, and I don't know if you have to leave to vote now, or if you have a few more minutes, because I really wanted to talk about another issue that, you know, maybe not front and center right at the moment, but has been for a number of years, sensible gun law, which, you know, here in, at least in New York City and in the state of New York, there is a, before the Supreme Court, test of the law to have a special permit to carry guns outside the home. A lot of states allow just carry anywhere. And this is likely to be struck down, at least perhaps being struck down in the state of New York, that that they have limitations on it. What is your view on that? Because you've been very vocal on this issue.
Yeah, in fact, when I was running for Congress in my purple place and my very equally divided Democrat and Republican place that had not been served by a Democrat ever in 163 years, I was told, do not talk about guns. Do not talk about gun safety. It will be the death of your ambitions. And I just said, you know what, if I can't talk about that, if I can't talk about it as an educator, as a mom, as somebody who's served in a uniform, then who else should? And I'm willing to say that if I do talk about that and that therefore I lose, then I'm not the right person to represent my community, because this is a really, really important issue. Gun safety is one of the things that people bring up all the time in my purple community, where 40% of us own firearms of one form or another. I'm saddened to say that at the federal level, we really haven't gotten anywhere in the last several years. I'm not really sure when we will, to be really honest. So this goes down to the local and state level, you know, largely, where we really have a lot of work to do. Pennsylvania is one of those places that has a great deal of work to do, but it's terrifying. And every single time, you know, somebody gives me a call after the most recent, you know, atrocity of one form or another, it bubbles back up. But every single time, as you said, it sort of goes back down into the common, you know, consciousness, and we don't hear about it again until some other equally offensive, you know, mass murder or mass shooting happens. So keep pushing on it is what I would say, and keep frankly voting for candidates and people who have this at the top of their agenda, because we really do need some serious reform, and we don't need military grade weapons on our streets.
For sure. But I think that the majority of the deaths are really caused day in and day out by firearms. Yeah.
Yep.
And I think people don't realize yet, even though there's plenty of information available, that the real tragedy is day in and day out deaths caused by firearms and arguments and, you know, people doing
mental health
things.
And death by suicide and all of those kinds of things. And also, you're right, we don't talk a lot about the, you know, kids in my community when I was teaching chemistry, who on the regular, probably once, twice, and three times a week, somebody within their immediate span, you know, would be shot for various different reasons. And so you're right, this is kind of an epidemic, a very quiet and silent epidemic, unfortunately, that mm-hmm. we're not aware enough about.
Mm-hmm. Talking about education, I just want to move to that area for questioning now, because you were a teacher yourself, teacher for America, obviously in great service, the country as a chemistry teacher. But now we've gone through 18 months of COVID, with kids in school, especially younger kids, I think, really are probably, you know, set back somewhat by having in school, out of school, online, back at school, out of school. There are, you know, and parents are exhausted by it, I would say. And we know that a lot of women have had to drop out of the workforce because of it. But I'm more interested in your opinions, being a teacher, about the effect on the students. And at different age levels, do you have a different opinion about how it affected them? And how do we get them back on track to really, the kind of learning progress they should be making at their age level?
I'm sorry, I'm just going to jump in here and say, Chrissy, you've got 1 minute. There are 37 members, though, who have not yet voted.
So, Michelle, would you like me to go vote? And am I coming back, or what's my cadence here?
You're a minute away from the floor.
Yeah.
Why don't you go vote and then come back and take a question or two and then okay. Go vote again.
And I will warn you that my internet is not working here in the room that I'm in, and I have my hotspot on my phone working, and I have 20% battery. So I hope that in all of that, everything will work. So I'll be right back.
Okay.
Please thank you very much if we don't get you to return. So perfect.
I told you she had common sense. It's really terrific. That was great, Kay. Maybe we could just have a little conversation with some of our group here. Anybody wants to add a comment? We have three questions from the floor when we get a chance to do it. And what we might do, Kay, to get everybody in, depending on how much time we have, and I'm sure you still have other questions too, is we could ask them to do the three questions at once, and then she can just do them all in order.
Absolutely. I take questions from the floor. I think people on the line, you know, who have questions with us, let's get their questions out. But I have more. We don't want to do that. Whatever.
I thought the gun question and the education are so important, particularly now. So, but I am curious if anybody has any comments about what they think the vote on Tuesday meant.
Well, to give one opinion, I don't know, am I unmuted?
That's Franz Leichter. One of my heroes from the New York State Senate from a while back. Great to have you on. Go ahead.
It was very clear that Democratic voters were apathetic. They didn't turn out. I think they were disenchanted with the lack of productivity in the Congress. And what I wanted to ask the Congress member when she comes back. Here she is.
Okay, the question was about education and early childhood education and learning loss. And the answer is it's complicated, right? Because it has to do, as you mentioned, with which child, whether you know young or middle school or high school, whether college, whether you know any other form of education. It's complicated when you have a different methodology of teaching. And I hope that at this point, we will go to thinking about whether or not we can localize the solutions. And so part of what I did through my own version of Springboard, one of you guys was introduced as having worked at Springboard or being on the board of Springboard. I helped to grow a company, a nonprofit called Springboard that focused on this exact issue, which is that kids primarily in urban and rural areas were learning about 6 months worth of literacy progress or gaining about 6 months worth of progress over the course of 9 months of education. And then they were losing as much as 3 months over the course of the summer. And this was obviously not okay, given the fact that other people's children were gaining 9 months. And then they were also not necessarily sliding backwards the three, in some cases gaining over the course of the year. And as a result in literacy specifically, and the same thing can be seen in numeracy, there were inequities. By the time somebody was in third or fourth grade, they were tragically behind. And in fact, many of the kids that I taught at 11th grade were reading at the third and fourth grade level. So then you layer over that COVID and you layer over it the inequities of a lot of our kids not having access to the internet or tablets or any sort of the ability for people to be engaged in helping them learn, maybe a parent or something like that. And we have a lost, you know, generation of people who, many generations of people who are now probably a year and a half and even more behind. So I guess my advocacy would be for this to be solved at the local level. I think that people know what's happening best within the classrooms that we're talking about and within the communities that we're talking about. And it takes resources to be able to think about that. It takes resources to be able to think about what kind of interventions we should be doing and whether or not they should be, I would say they probably should involve adults in the, you know, in that child's life or in the young adult's life. I think it probably should involve strengthening the training that exists in classrooms right now. And some of the legislation that we're passing right now with Build Back Better actually talks about this building capacity within schools and not having it kind of parachuted in, but rather trying to figure out what have we learned through the pandemic? What do we know about education and how do we supplement what we've lost? But I do worry. I was walking through a park. I was watching a young mom talking to her infant with a mask on. And I was thinking, wow, you know, what's happening to that whole age group of kids that aren't necessarily seeing even their mom's, you know, expression all the time? What's going to happen that we need to, you know, recover from? Same thing, frankly, with mental health issues. I know that mental health issues have become chronic amongst school-aged kids all the way through college and frankly, similarly with adults too. So much of the resources that we're looking in for some of these larger packages and from some of the packages we've already passed address the mental health issues too, but hopefully sending that down to communities and local governances.
On that issue again, in preschool, universal preschool, I'm old enough to remember that we had 2 years of kindergarten when I went to school in public school, the suburb of Milwaukee, and I actually broke into kindergarten when I was 3 years old and insisted on being there for some reason. I thought it was really cool, and so I had more, even more. But I think that people don't realize that the brain develops in the first 3 years of life. The brain is 80% developed. And if we don't get this universal kindergarten available for young, you know, children, they're in the position that you just talked about. They're never going to catch up if they haven't come to first grade with knowledge of how to read literacy.
And it's even as simple
as recognize the letters and so forth.
Yeah. It's even as simple as not even getting to that point. There are, at by the time you're a 2 or 3 year old and maybe just hitting 4, if you haven't had the exercise of understanding that this is a book and that it opens, at least in our area, this way, and that you know, track in this manner, this is not about, do I know what my letters and numbers are? Do I know what they sound like? This is just that skill, that understanding, you're already behind. And so it's pretty easy to be chronically behind without things like pre-K, things like universal, frankly, childcare, where you also learn some of those skills too.
Right. Learn some of the socialization skills. You know, there's a lot of tension. We just talked about it, a lot of tension in Washington, and that's different from the local level. And I think we all have to learn to talk about what's important on the local level for people to get elected. Maybe we're learning some of this in recent elections, but I think that I would like to know if all through this trial period of time, what is the most humorous thing has happened to you? Have there been any humorous moments for you? Let me think. There must be something to make your day light up once in a while.
I don't know if Michelle, can I'm going to tell it. So it's really interesting to be here because I, as I started the conversation, shared with you that I never expected that this would be, you know, my path. And so I was fortunate enough to be on a congressional delegation for the 75th anniversary of Normandy. And it was a very big congressional delegation. There were 40 or 60 members. And I was sitting next to a member whom I very much admire and but didn't know very well at that time. And she's now the chair of one of my subcommittees, Jackie Spear. And we were just talking and I was just talking about myself and chattering or whatever. And at one point in time, I just said, well, she's really drunk the Kool-Aid. And Jackie Spears stopped me and said, you probably shouldn't say that to me. And if anybody knows Jackie Spears' background, she actually was one of the people on the ground during that particular situation and was shot and almost died as a result of that particular event in Jonestown when I was just a child, you know, a young person. Yeah. So it's not funny, but it's funny, you know, because you just the awesomeness of humans who are around you here is just incalculable. And the experiences, the life experiences of people, you know, I learned that one of our colleagues is one of the original Black Panthers. That's awesome. It's really, really awesome that people are here that I serve with. One of my colleagues is the first woman and Black speaker of the House in California. Just history makers are amongst me, John Lewis, you know. So even though that's, you know, kind of off color and not necessarily my finest, proudest moment, it just definitely was a moment of levity. And another one is I have gotten to know Liz Cheney pretty well. And we were just chit-chatting and things like that and talking about our dogs. And we have the same dogs' names and things like that. And we share in common that we have daughters both who are getting married, hers this October, mine next October. Mine is marrying a woman. And so that it was an interesting collision of conversations as well. So there's just all this interesting stuff that goes on here with a lot of people who are really cool and nice to learn from.
Well, that's Chrissy, great. I'm sorry. I know that Chrissy, you could stay here all afternoon, but you do have to go.
keep voting.
Well, thank you so much. I'm really delighted to have you here today and really proud to have you represent us in Congress from the 6th district.
Thank you. And for those of you guys who commented and questions. Thank you very much for your questions. I take my job really deadly seriously, trying to do my very, very best to represent both our community and the Commonwealth of Pennsylvania and the country and to advance us. And I also part of a scrum of 435 on this side and 100 on that side. And so this is quite an effort to get things across the finish line. So doing my best, and I'll make whatever I can happen as soon as I can. But thank you so much for the chance to talk to you guys.
Oh, you're doing great. We're so honored to have had you, Representative Houlahan. Thank you so much. And thank you, Kay, for terrific questions. Sorry we couldn't get to all your questions from the audience, but perhaps we could send them to your office. You might have time to have somebody send it back. We really appreciate it.
Sure. You're welcome, guys. Please be well.
You too. Thank you so much.